Well, good morning. How many of you are glad to be here today? Half of you, that's great.
Very good.
If you have your Bibles, would you open them up with me before we get started to Acts chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 10 through 11. How many of you get a sense, because we see every single day, that the Lord is coming back soon? Would you agree with that? There are so many things taking place in our world today. It's almost very difficult to keep up with everything that is taking place. What is interesting, if you look in the feast of what's taking place in Israel, Yom Kippur is taking place September 23rd. I want you to especially be aware of what's going to be taking place. Do you know when Jesus came the first time, there were those who were wise who had a sense that Jesus was coming, and those who were wise, the wise men who were seeking him, came and knew that he was coming. And so I believe we are called to be wise to get a sense of the season in which Jesus is coming back. The Bible says no man knows the day nor the hour when Jesus is coming back. But there is a sense of a potential when a season in which Jesus may come back. And if you look at the feast in, around September 23rd and through 28th and through a couple of weeks of October, where we have the Day of Atonement taking place, we have the blood moons. How many of you have heard of the blood moons taking place? Well, a lot of these things are taking place during the fall. And so what I would like you to do is to be aware, really look at the news of what's taking place. In fact, if you want to jot a few of these things down, I want to encourage you to look in the next coming weeks, maybe at some natural disaster. Also, keep an eye on the Pope in the next few weeks of announcements and things that he may make and things that are taking place with there. And so it is interesting, these next couple weeks, we are ripe for a natural disaster taking place. Look at economies. Look what's taking place. It is interesting, as I'm studying Babylon, Mystery Babylon, a lot of people believe that could be the United States, talking about that. It says that the Mystery Babylon will be in darkness. And how many of you have heard of an EMP? Anybody know? Well, it's a weapon that China and Russia has been working on to develop, where they could come over to the United States, set this EMP off. They could be 20 miles above the surface and set this off. And what they want to do is they want to wipe out all the power grids in the United States. How many of you know most of the world hates Israel and most of the world hates the United States? And so they would like to wipe Israel off the face of the earth, and they would like to defeat the great Satan, which is the United States and a lot of Muslims' eyes around the world. And so know that in the last days, the United States is a mention. And so it is a very sobering effect of what could take place in our world today. That's why it's good that we're prepared spiritually, number one, and physically, and all those type things. Because it's I know growing up, and some of you are around my age still looking good, but you're older. And I can remember a time when the United States seemed so powerful and so strong that nothing could come against it. Well, I don't have that feeling anymore, do you? I believe we are ripe for some things to take place. Our freedoms and our power and our strength and authority in the world has diminished. And there are so many things taking place with the refugees around the world taking place that as you see some of the pictures of the refugees, geez, and the things that they are shouting, it doesn't appear that they're leaving for the reasons they say. I believe they want to infiltrate different countries and bring about some of the agendas that the Muslims have. There's also a gentleman in our church, and he's been working a lot of hours, and I said, what for? And he said, well, he goes, we're making, what his company does is they make temporary and mobile solar-powered places that are mounted, can be mounted on vehicles that can be placed in different places. Well, he said the government is trying to get as many as they can before the end of the year. And so they have a contract, and not just here in this area, but they have them all over the United States, and they're trying to get as many mobile devices as possible. I believe that our country knows that something is coming up. They are storing food, they are storing up gold and silver, and so I just say all that to say in the next maybe 4 weeks, pay attention to what is happening. Pay attention to what is coming out of the Pope's mouth, and be aware of what is taking place on the news. Would you do that? And be aware of the signs of the time. Also, have a repentant heart in these next couple weeks. Just repent for your sins, for our nation's sins before the Lord, and we just pray for revival. Would you also remember to pray for those who are being persecuted all over the world? Again, every week I look at something, and it's just mind-boggling how people can be so barbaric and kill believers in such a barbaric way. Well, if you have your Bibles, how many of you have your Bibles today? Very good. I have $1,000 for each person who brought their Bible. Unfortunately, it's monopoly money. But anyway. I got your attention there, didn't I? Acts chapter 1, and I'm going to look at verses 10 and 11. If you have your Bibles, if not, pay attention. This is when Jesus, the ascension of Jesus, the first time, it says, "And as they were gazing intently into the sky," this is the disciples, "while he was going, behold, two men," say two men, "in white clothing stood beside them. They also said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into the sky? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven.'" And so here we have the ascension of Jesus Christ going up. There's two men in white, most likely to be angels, right? And so we see here that the angels are saying to the disciples and the men of Galilee, "Why do you stand here watching him go?" In other words, to say, don't just stand here, go out and do what you're called to do. And that was to preach the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? So in that same way, I believe we are called to watch, but I believe we're more importantly called for our purpose, and that purpose is to tell other people about the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? More people have accepted the Lord in the first half of this year than any other time in the history of our church. More people have been baptized, and I believe God is up to something. I believe people sense the coming of the Lord. Even people who don't know the Lord will respond to the things that are happening in our world today. And I believe the field is ready for harvest. And I believe there will be a great awakening. I believe there will be a great revival in our land. And so I believe we are all called in the same way, not just to stand here and watch, but we're called to go and to be witnesses for the Lord. Amen? Well, if you get your outlines out with me this morning, we are in Revelation chapter 11. And each of our services are growing. Our first service was packed. We're full here. God is doing something. You guys must be enjoying this series in Revelation. Yes. The reason why we enjoy it, I believe, is because we can see these things and the potential of things unfold before our very eyes. Amen? And so we are here in the first part of the tribulation. What starts the tribulation? A 7-year peace treaty between the Antichrist and Israel. It will allow them to rebuild the temple. If you were to look at the first verses of chapter 11, which is not on your outline, it talks about measuring the temple. So we know at this time there the temple is there. We know that this takes place in Israel where the temple will be. So far so good? Look what it says in Revelation 11:3. "And I will grant authority to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth." Let's stop there. 1,260 days, how long is that? Divided by 42 months, which comes out to 3.5 years. See, you guys already knew this stuff, right? No, you didn't. Anyway, 3.5 years, we see that authority will be given to two witnesses, and they will prophesy for these 3.5 years, and they are clothed in what?
Sackcloth.
Sackcloth. Not too popular garment these days, correct? It's very symbolic of the Old Testament. It's symbolic more of the law than it is of grace. It's also a symbol of humility, of mourning, And so we see that these two witnesses, and I think we have a diagram of, do we have a diagram? There we go. So during this time, we're in the trumpet seal judgments. So this is most likely the first 3.5 years of the tribulation. We know that during this time, the first half, there'll be 144,000 witnesses that will go out through all the earth witnessing. And then we have at this time two witnesses that will be witnesses at the same time, but they'll be witnesses in Israel. And they'll be sharing all these things taking place in Israel. Let's go on to verse 4 and 5 here. It says this: "These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. And if anyone wants to harm them, fire flows out of their mouth and devours their enemies. So if anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed in this way." Let's go to verse 6. "These have the power to shut up the sky so that the rain will not fall during the days of their prophesying. And they have power over the waters to turn them into blood and to strike the earth with every plague as often as they desire." Kind of sounds like Old Testament stuff, doesn't it? Crazy stuff taking place. Well, who are these two witnesses? How many of you want to know who they are? Too bad. Anyway, there are about 4 or 5 theories out there. I've kind of added one myself. But the theory is these are two Old Testament witnesses that will come and have these plagues go on the earth. And so the first school of thought is that one is Enoch and the other one is Elijah. And the reason that this first theory applies is because we know that the Bible says that Enoch walked with God and then he was no more. So God took him up. We also know that Elijah, right, never died as well. He went up in a chariot of fire. And so we see that those two gentlemen never died. And so the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. So since these two gentlemen never died, they believe that it's going to be one of those two. But how many of you know, or how many of you hope when the Lord comes back, we won't die either? We'll go to be with the Lord. So that theory may not work because there's a lot of people who will be caught up in the rapture who will not die. So we see that it doesn't necessarily apply in that way. The other theory is that it is Elijah. We know that Elijah, he was one that shut the rains up in heaven and did not allow it to rain, right? We also know that Elijah says, "If I am the man of God, may fire come down and devour you." And the fire came down and devoured some of the men that came against him. That sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? And so we see that one of these fits Elijah. And in fact, Jesus himself mentions it in Matthew 17, 11. And Jesus answered and said unto them, "Elijah truly shall first come and restore all things." In Malachi 4, 5, it says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." And in Jewish tradition, they save a place at the table for Elijah to come back. And so we see here that most likely one of them could be Elijah. And then it also says in the text here that we see that he has the power over the waters to turn into blood. Who does that sound like? Moses, right? And the reason it's believed that Elijah and Moses could be that is because on the Mount of Transfiguration, where Jesus was there with two of the disciples, they saw who? Moses and Elijah. And so that's one belief that it could be those two men because of that. Another theory that we see is Moses put the plagues upon the earth. Some of those same plagues will be on the earth, just in a greater scale. And then also, it says here that authority will be given to them to strike the earth with every plague, listen to this, as often as they desire. As often as they desire. So if you can picture these two men in Israel, dressed in sackcloth, they are testimonies of who Christ is, and not only are they a testimony of Jesus Christ, how many of you know that? They wouldn't be too popular just at that point. How many of you know if you stand up for Jesus Christ in our world today or in the media today, they'll shout you down? And then not only that, but also these two men are putting plagues upon the whole earth. How many of you know they're not going to be popular, right? And so we see that these two men who are witnesses have the ability to put plagues on the earth as they feel needed. So God is obviously trusting these two guys, right? And I tell you, I'd rather be with the Lord, but wouldn't it be cool to watch these guys? Yeah. And so we see that here in verse 6. Let's go to verse 7 and verse 8. It says, "And when they had finished their testimony, the beast that comes up out of the abyss will make war with them and overcome them and kill them." Let's stop right there. So that's why it's believed the beast will come out of the pit. That's why it's believed that it's going to be towards the first half of the tribulation here. And when they have finished their testimony, the beast that comes out of the abyss will make war with them. He will overcome them. And what will happen to them? He will kill them. Well, let me give you one more theory on who the two witnesses are. There's another theory. If we see in that text that I read in Acts, notice there were how many men standing there?
Two.
Dressed in white? Two men, right? The Bible says that there must be two witnesses. And so we see here, when Jesus was ascending, there were two angels there, right? We know that when, we know on the mercy seat, right? The Old Testament, in the Holy of Holies, there is a mercy seat. And it has two angels, right? We know when Mary looked into the tomb, the text says she looked in and she saw two angels, one at the head where Jesus would have been and one at the foot. And so we see, then it mentions later on Sodom and Egypt. We know in Sodom that two angels were sent, right, to warn Lot and to get his family out of Sodom. We know in Egypt there's a death angel. And so one school of thought is that it can be two angels. That could be the two witnesses. We know that angels are immortal, right? We know that the Lord would trust them in that way. And so there's a whole lot of theory. There's even another theory. It's Elijah and John the Baptist. So to say all that, no one knows. No one knows. And so I believe that fact is not that important compared to the time frame they're going to be here, how long they're going to be here, and what they are here for. Are you with me so far? Okay, so here we have verse 8. "And their dead bodies will lie in the street of the great city, which is mystically is called Sodom in Egypt, where also their Lord was crucified." So here we have that the Antichrist comes and the beast comes and kills them. And it says they'll kill them. And then in this text it says their dead bodies will lie in the streets. And the literal translation is their carcasses, like dead animals, will lie in the street. So that's kind of crazy, doesn't it? And so here we see that these witnesses, they're in the streets of the mystically called city of Sodom and Egypt, which is Jerusalem, where Jesus was crucified, right? And so he's telling us a sense of the sinfulness which is represented in Sodom, also in Egypt, right? It's a symbol of bondage. It's a symbol of sin where the people were freed from. So here we see in this text, it's taking place in Israel, where the Antichrist comes and kills these two witnesses. Their dead bodies is lying in the streets. Let's go to verse 9. And it says, "Those from the people and the tribes and the tongues and nations will look at their bodies for 3.5 days and will not permit their dead bodies to be laid in the tomb." Let's stop there for a moment. So it says those peoples and tribes and tongues and nations will what? Will look at their dead bodies. What does that mean? Well, it means that all the nations, all the peoples, all the tongues will witness. They will all look and witness this news taking place. How many of you know it's possible for about everyone to see what's going on in the world today, right? We have everything at our very fingertips. So all the nations, all the world, I believe all the TV cameras will be on these dead bodies because it will make news and headlines, as you'll see in the text. And so their bodies were not permitted to be laid in a tomb. So they were not allowed to be buried, right? So their dead bodies were in the streets. Now let's look in verse 11. But after the 3.5 days, which is actually 3.5 days here, the breath of life from God came into them, and they stood on their feet, and great fear fell upon those who were watching. How many of you know that would be crazy, right? So what is happening? These two witnesses were not very popular. The Antichrist comes and kills them. Anti, it means against Christ. How many of you know the spirit of Antichrist is among us, where there are people against Christ? So we can see that we're ushering in this type of mentality. We see these dead bodies as carcasses lying in the streets. And what happens is, after 3.5 days, can you imagine this? All the TV cameras are on these dead bodies. And all of a sudden, it says the breath of God comes into them, and the literal translation is they stand to their feet. And probably the TV cameras will conveniently get turned off. How many of you know a lot of people are going to be freaked out in that moment right there? Because they have killed and destroyed. They celebrated, giving gifts, celebrating. It'll be like part Mardi Gras, part Christmas taking place because they will so celebrate. Why are they celebrating? Because of the testimony of these two witnesses and the plagues and the torment in which they put upon the earth. And so very powerful that we see in this context here. So in verse 10, we see, and those who dwell on the earth, I think I missed that. Can we go to verse 10, Zachary? It says this, and those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them, and what?
Celebrate.
Let me try that again. And those who dwell on the earth will rejoice over them, and?
Celebrate.
And they will send gifts to one another, because these two prophets tormented those who dwell on the earth. So again, these guys will be celebrating, right? They'll be rejoicing because these guys are dead. They're going to be sending gifts to people in celebration. It's going to be like Christmas Day. Kind of like pagan Christmas, kind of like what we're kind of like celebrating today, where we forget about Christ, right? And so here we see the celebration takes place. Then these guys come to life. So they were celebrating, they were rejoicing, they were partying. All of a sudden, these guys come to life. Do you think the fear of the Lord came upon them? Yes. Let's go to verse 12. And they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, come up here. Then they went up to heaven in the cloud, and their enemies watched them. Can you imagine that? These dead bodies are lying in the streets. All of a sudden, 3.5 days, they come to life. And then a voice from heaven, and everybody's watching this, right? Every tongue, every tribe, every nation, the world is witnessing this. Then there is a voice from heaven that says, come up here. And it shows these guys literally going up into the clouds. Again, the world will see this, and how many of you know the world will be freaked out? The fear of the Lord will be upon them. And then look what happens here in verse 13. And in that hour there was a great earthquake, and a tenth of the city fell. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, And the rest were terrified, say terrified,
terrified,
and gave glory to God of heaven. Doesn't mean they were saved, but it means that they were so terrified they gave glory to the Lord because they realized it is God who does this. There will still be people that will never repent because of their pride and selfishness and arrogance. And so we see here, though, that the fear of the Lord will come upon them. Just as there was a great earthquake when Jesus Christ died, there will be a great earthquake during this time. It says 7,000 will be killed. And so most likely, and the term is actually a term of those kind of the elite. It can also be a reference of those who had a part in killing these, who had a part of coming against them. And those 7,000 were destroyed, but the fear of the Lord came upon all the rest of them. And out of sheer terror and fear, watching this, they gave glory to the Lord. Isn't it good news we get to freely give glory to the Lord now?
Amen.
Because of His mercy and His grace upon each and every one of us. And then the seven trumpets still here. It's the kingdom of God being declared. Look what it says here in verse 15. Then the seventh angel sounded, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ, and He will reign forever and ever. The text goes on to say two woes are past, and there's one more woe to come. How many of you know when the Bible says woe, you got to take heed, right? That's a big woe. And so here we see what's taking place. Listen, out of all the times in history where you and I could be alive and well, God has chosen all of us to be here today. All of us have been chosen to be, I believe, last days people. Those people who were called by the living God. I believe it is our responsibility that the Lord would have us to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Again, can you imagine if you knew you were like the two witnesses who were immortal until their job was done and the Lord took them? You know what? We're immortal until the Lord's done with us. And so that's why we can have the holy boldness to proclaim Jesus Christ. Again, we have the freedom to do that. One day, I don't believe we will. That's why we have the freedom. We need to do it. Because, listen, a couple things. Will there be anybody in heaven? Will there be anybody in heaven because of you? Wouldn't that be great to be in heaven? Says, thank you for sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. I love when Pastor Ken says their neighbor came across the street and invited them to church. Change their whole family. Will you be that person? I believe all of us are called to be witnesses. And listen, when the Lord comes back, I mean, you know, they'll remember every single word you said. And it'll come back to their remembrance. So boldly proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Yeah.
Good news is simply this. We're all sinners. And Christ died and took the wrath upon Himself. I'm glad. As we see, Enoch was taken with the Lord. We see the fact that Noah, before judgment came upon the earth, went into the safety of the ark, and the Lord protected him. I thank the Lord that the wrath of God that should have went upon Brian, the wrath of God that should have went upon you, we were spared all that because all that wrath went upon Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
How many of you know that's good news right there?
Yeah.
The Bible says, one day every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I want to see as many people who can confess that now. Amen? Again, in the next couple weeks, would you have your eyes open? Be watching the news and see what is taking place in our world. Also, would you take time during this week and the weeks to come, this next 4 weeks, just repent of your sins. Maybe even repent to the Lord for our nation's sins, that we might see revival take place. Amen?
Amen.
Also, would you remember those who are being persecuted for their faith? And would you lift them up in prayer that God would protect them, guide them, give them strength? strength, that the presence of the living God would be there with them. Amen?
Amen.
God is so good and so faithful. I'm going to invite Pastor Ken up to come this morning and to lead us in prayer. And I want to challenge you, be ready. Amen? The Amen. Lord is coming back soon. God bless you.
Amen.
You know, growing up in the church, I've heard and listened to the teaching through the book of Revelation multiple times, but this time is so different because we're so close. And we're seeing it unfold. When it talks about that, every tribe and every tongue and every nation will witness these individuals lying in the streets. Well, 25 years ago, we're like, what does that even mean? How's that even possible? Today, we can see that it is possible. And so as we're going through this series of Revelation, it's clicking so much better than 20 years ago, 30 years ago. It's amazing. And with that being said, we all have to agree that we're close. Amen? We're close. And obviously, we don't give you all this information to scare you, but to prepare you. And not just to prepare you intellectually, but spiritually. And something that we can take great comfort in is when Jesus said that, you know what? There's only one way to the Father, and that's through me. And when we give our life to Christ, that's the most important thing you need to do to prepare yourself spiritually. Regardless of how this all unravels, whether it's in the next year, 5 years, 10 years, the most important thing you need to do today is to know that spiritually you are prepared for whatever God does or whatever takes place in our world. And so I want to challenge you this morning, like never before, if you are here this morning and you're not right with God, or you've never accepted or bowed your heart to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then it is not a coincidence that you are here this morning.
Amen.
Because I believe that God wants to save your soul and to call you His own. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your incredible love. We thank you, Lord, for your willingness to sacrifice and to lay down your life so that each and every one of us spiritually might have life everlasting. Thank you for going to the cross and paying the debt that we owe. Thank you for paying the price. And that, Lord, your word says that whoever shall believe in you shall have life everlasting. And for that, thank you. With every head bowed, every eye closed at this private moment, I want to ask you, if you've never bowed your heart to Christ, if you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, or maybe it was years ago in Sunday school, but since then life has happened, and you've drifted, and you know in your heart of hearts, you're not right with God this morning. I need you to do some soul searching. I need you to really evaluate the condition of your heart this morning. Because I really believe that God is wanting to redeem the lost this morning. I believe that God wants to touch lives. That we understand that it's more than life is, there's so much more than just the here and now. Getting up and going to work and coming home. So much more than getting out of this place so we can watch the football games. But God, the creator of heaven and earth, wants to meet with you this morning. And so if that's you, you say, you know what? I want to accept Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. I want to leave this place knowing in my heart of hearts that I'm right with God. If that's you, with nobody looking around, I'm not going to have you stand up. I'm not going to have you come forward. But if you would, just slip your hand up. I'm going to pray. If you need Christ, I see your hand in the back. Thank you. Just raise your hand. I see your hand. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? In the back there, thank you. In the back there. On the right, thank you. Say, you know what? I want to leave this place right with God. Anybody else? Just going to give it a quick moment. Praise the Lord. Church, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I want you to repeat after me. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for sending your Son to take my place on the cross and to forgive me of my sins. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for laying your life down so that I would have life. And one day, I will stand in eternity in all of glory with you forever and ever. Give me the strength to live for you. May I be your witness. In Jesus' mighty name. And all of God's people said,
Amen.